Welcome back, geology fans. Last episode, we found the two formations of the Pier Shale grading into the Fox Hill Sandstone and took lots of notes. Time to take strike and dip along with all these notes in our field notebook. But how do you take strike and dip here? Where did the face of the layers go? Uh-oh. This outcrop face is almost perfectly perpendicular to the beds of rock. We only barely see the face of the layers to measure sticking out in slightly differentially eroding layers as they gradationally change. We may need to amplify the layers with a notebook to emphasize the surface upon which we are taking strike and dip. Right-hand rule says take the strike into the face of the rock to get a strike of 138 and a dip of 70, which should be 70 degrees to the west. And recall, this is overturned. The symbol for an overturned bed is a hook that ends up pointing in the observed direction of dip. Here our beds dip to the west and strike with a northwest-southeast trend, so we place a line that is closely perpendicular to this rock face for the strike, and then a dip line that loops back to the east and ends up pointing west. We write 70 at the end of this dip pointer, and we have just let everyone else know that this location has overturned rocks striking and dipping as so. As for that fault we have evidence going through here, it is not the golden fault itself, but a likely offshoot, like secondary cracks in broken pottery. We will put a solid line through the obviously brecciated segments to indicate this fault where we know it's existing, and perhaps dashing off to the north and south where we could guess it might extend. We can always make a dashed line solid if we find further evidence of this fault to make a more confident mark. Hard to tell relative motion on this fault yet, so we will look for more evidence. We see no difference in strike and dip across the gradational contact between the pier and Fox Hills, so our dashed line gradational contact should be parallel to our measured strike, 138. We can color in the formations in just a little bit until we see more. Now, what is that surficial material? Poorly sorted clastic deposit of sub-rounded to sub-angular clasts. Says, "Hi there, I'm a glacial diamictite." Right? Many metamorphic clasts show it was eroded out of those mountains over there during glacial times and placed on top of these already tilted layers and after the mountains were uplifted. This is probably from one of our previous glacial maximums. So think like 23,000 up to a few hundred thousand years old possibility, probably around 23,000 years ago to the outwash melting period of about 12,000 years ago, really. That's a lot younger than where we left off at 69 million years old in the Fox Hill Sandstone. So don't put this glacial deposit in your historical report. Next, don't put it in until the near end of your report. If we want a smooth story, we know we must proceed to the next tilted layer. Actually, slightly overturned, meaning layer to the east. This next layer sequence up produced ribs of rock that stick out. We can touch the rock making these ribs, and feels like sandpaper to the touch. So, hey, guess what? Sandstone. We identify these sandstone ribs. But between the ribs, the rock is mostly missing. But where some of the material remains, we occasionally see mud cracks. It's mud. It's mudstone, really, not shale. So more likely deposited on land. So we have these ribs of sandstone and removed sections of mudstone. The sandstone is not laterally consistent. It doesn't keep the same thickness across large distances, like in the Pier Shale we just saw. Inconsistent thickness sands, interbedded with mud. As we poke around the ribs, we occasionally find fossils. Lots of plant fossils. Lots of leaf fossils. Now, leaves come from trees, and trees don't grow in the ocean. They grow on land. We have, as we predicted, a land-based deposit on top of the slightly uplifting and regressing sea regression sequence previously observed in the Pier and Fox Hills. What terrestrial, land-based environment is good at putting down inconsistent thickness sands interbedded with mud? Rivers. Fluvial deposits fit the bill. And these leaf fossils. As a paleoclimatologist, I know that there is something about leaves that is a useful climate indicator. In cold climates, think Canada, you find broadleaf leaves with sharp, jagged edges, eh? But as you get down south to warmer climes like North Texas, you find more rounded mitten-shaped leaves, and then when you end up down near the equator, you get these tropical rainforests and find smooth-edged leaves with often drip tips. The leaf fossils found in these sands are smooth-edged and show drip tips. Oh, and palm fronds. Yeah, so welcome to the Laramie Formation, a 68-million-year-old fluvial deposit in a tropical rainforest. Still in the age of dinosaurs. A tropical rainforest? Here? Wow, plate tectonics must really have moved us, huh? Well, and yet the Yellowstone hotspot track shows North America rotating clockwise, so we're close enough to the center of rotation to not have moved in latitude much at all since the Laramie Formation was deposited 68 million years ago. We have changed altitude. We started at sea level in the Fox Hills beach sands, and though that sea has fallen hundreds of meters since then, the land has also come up over a mile from its former elevation, so there is that change. So rivers in a tropical rainforest near sea level become today's semi-arid climate a mile above sea level with mountains in our backyard, all at about the same latitude. These are interesting river deposits with the stark boundaries and thick sand units. More regional investigation reveals a channel to the north where the river really tended to run. It apparently formed levees on its banks through successive flooding, laying down the mud on the floodplain where we now see removed slots. But when the levees got to a certain height, the water would occasionally burst through a part of the levee in a crevasse splay. The fossils are made by rapid burial of the floodplain tropical rainforest with a sudden high-energy, sand-rich blast coming from the north. A more regional look shows a series of rivers doing this off the slowly uplifting Rocky Mountain core, depositing horizontal mud and crevasse splays that are now tipped over. We can eye the strike and dip from here and see it's basically the same as the Pier in Fox Hills, about 138 or 140 strike, 70-ish degree dip to the west. Overturned. So we put a similar overturned strike and dip symbol here and color in the Laramie Formation as we see it. We can make a strat column, and a resistance column is useful. So Pier Shale recedes back into valleys, while Fox Hill Sandstone sticks out farther and keeps up ridges. But then the Laramie goes from this easily eroded mud to more resistant sand, and then back again, so we get this wavy pattern of erosion on the top layer, and can put in rock pattern symbols for what we've seen so far. Looking at this, you made this by walking just a few meters across a small section of our campus. And in that, you saw an intercontinental sea regressing to a mangrove swamp beach, which then gave way to a tropical rainforest with flooding rivers, breaching levees, and burying ecosystems as fossils. Students at the Colorado School of Mines should stop and realize how lucky they are. I don't know of any other campus that has such rich geology exposed right in its backyard. Oh, and wait until you see what else we got here, okay? So most of my colleagues went to schools where we had to drive for hours to see something other than shale or limestone we tended to live in, at least in the middle of the continent. Now, if you're into fossil finding, you should realize that you can't look on any side of these crevasse splay sandstone ribs to find fossils. You have to look on their lower side, the bottom side, the side that buried everything. I sure hope you can remember which side is the lower side here. We have not changed direction, and so the bottom of the stack is still to the west, and we are walking up the stack to the east, and so the fossils are going to be on the bottom west faces of the sandstone in the Laramie Formation. So originally the top of the mud sections was a shallow soil, now paleosol, that grew the tropical rainforest trees here, and it makes sense for mud to erode back more than sandstone, but you know, here on campus the difference seems a bit extreme. And as we walk over the low spots here, there's actually river cobble filling in the slots. It sure doesn't look sorted, and it doesn't look like it was from a river. It was just dumped here as fill, riprap. These muds were actively mined out. Not all mud is equal. This mud is kaolinite-rich mud, and it will fuse when heated, and so you can make things like ceramics, coarse ceramics, and bricks, kafatar bricks, with it. After the city of Denver took the title of capital of the territory from Golden, yeah, we used to be the capital, not named after Golden, actually it was named after Tom Golden, who had a store down here, but Denver passed a law to stop building with wood. Yeah, so we are in a semi-arid environment, and wooden structures burn real nice. So no more wood means build out of brick. The biggest cost for many materials is transportation, and so Denver got their clay from the mud slots of the Laramie Formation, not just on our campus, but all along the Front Range, as close as possible. These Laramie clays are still being actively mined to the south near Dinosaur Ridge, but you need to fire the clay to make brick. And the Denver had a nearby fuel source as well, also in the Laramie Formation. One of the upper beds of the Laramie Formation, where you think there might be mud, there was coal instead. Bituminous to sub-bituminous coal. And so the white ash mine operation, coal mining operation, began on our campus. If you follow the strike of the beds along the coal seam, it was on the east side of our ridge of Laramie. Go across the creek on this strike, and you'll see over there the Loveland Mine Park, where there are no houses built. The reason to place the park there instead of houses is that the location of the old mine shaft, which was dug in the middle of the 1800s, before the secondary white ash mine was dug on our campus, was placed there, and differential settling of the mined area prohibits building houses, but a playground and a park are fine. The north shaft is now known as Loveland Mine Park and was called the New Loveland Mine. It went about 400 feet down, cutting towards the creek at each 100-foot level. And once abandoned in the 1880s, the New Loveland Mine was just filled with water, filled with water. Through the 1880s, the White Ash Mine was dug down on campus to a depth of over 700 feet below the surface, cutting out a level every 100 feet again. The concern was really with the 200-foot level, where our mine on campus cut towards the creek, and the old mine shaft had been coming towards the creek, and they approached each other the closest of any level. So the mine safety inspector insisted on a barrier wall of 70 to 100 feet of coal left under the creek between the two mine operations. But it appears that a fire in the mine dump worked its way underground, and by September of 1889, the fire had reached the 200-foot level. Now, the mine inspector figured he'd seen it about a year before and figured it was underground and would choke itself out. But hey, lessons from places like Centralia, Pennsylvania, where a fire has been burning underground for decades in an old coal mine, we know that many of these subterranean coal fires persist. And in 1889, the fire under our campus burned through the coal barrier connecting the two mines and allowed a breach on September 9th, 1889, that flushed the water from the Loveland mine into the White Ash mine with enough force to take out all the mine works past the 200-foot level. Many were working the 600-foot level that day, but could have easily been forced down even to the 700-foot level by the flooding. There was no chance of rescue nor recovery of the bodies. So pay your respects to the 10 dead miners. The lone miner statue we passed on the way up is approximately where the old shaft was, and the names of those lost men are on a plaque for the White Ash Mine disaster. The three loops you see next to some names signify members of the Odd Fellows, whose dues would help sustain their family in the case of their death in the mine. The three rings, by the way, for the Odd Fellows symbolize friendship, love, and truth. So with our map as complete as we can so far, we marvel at the geology on our campus and look forward to what we find next here on Earth Explorations.